Do we ever imagine what it might have been like to be one of the disciples of Jesus included in that innermost circle, such that you would have found yourself sequestered in the upper room with the others? Indeed, in the very same room where Jesus had gathered you for a final meal before his crucifixion and death? Well, if we were to imagine it, and imagine it at this particular time in the gospel, it probably wasn't the most pleasant place to be late on Thursday night and throughout Friday and Saturday, and indeed on most of the day Sunday, at least till about this time in the early evening. Most who were there admittedly had fled out of fear when Jesus was arrested and condemned to death. In fact, only the Apostle John, his mother Mary, Mary of Magdala, Mary the wife of Clopas, and a few other women in the group had the courage to stay at the foot of the cross. There was a lot of grief in that room, certainly, at the loss of their master, their teacher, their friend. There had to be a lot of guilt, too, among the many who had not stood by him till the end, and some shame at their cowardice. There was certainly anxiety concerning a now uncertain future. After having followed Jesus for so long, it had to be depressing for most of them, because it must have all seemed for naught. Where was the kingdom that Jesus had preached and had promised? Why hadn't it come the way they expected it to? And instead, Jesus faced an unjust and horrible death. And as we are told that the doors to that house and even to that upper room were locked, we can be certain there was a lot of fear among that group of insiders. Fear for their own safety, wondering, would they be the next to be hanging on a cross? And confusion, because some had reported that morning that the body was missing from the tomb, and there was speculation as to what that really meant, and skepticism, because some were saying they had even seen Jesus again. But that seemed too good to be true, too hard to believe. So into this upper room of so many mixed and really largely negative emotions, skepticism, self-recrimination, fear and uncertainty, into this comes Jesus. And what is his first word to those disciples? One might have expected a word of chastisement, maybe some blaming, but it's quite the opposite, isn't it? The first word is peace. And it's not just stated, it's prayerfully wished. And so it's actually received. Received because Jesus is alive and truly with them. And while different in that he could appear in that room in spite of the locked doors, yet Jesus is still in most essential aspects quite the same. His mortal wounds are visible, but he's quite alive. And the peace his appearance brings cannot help but also impart joy. And so we hear that those disciples in the inner circle rejoiced. Indeed, the truth of Jesus' resurrection, his greeting of peace, his speech about forgiveness are all healing. And when a week later, the once absent Thomas, who is still stuck in what is only natural, skepticism, when he sees for himself that Jesus truly lives, he responds not by asking for those proofs he so boldly demanded to see the week before, as there is no actual placing of his fingers into Jesus' wounds. Rather, there is an immediate and huge leap of faith on Thomas's part. as he humbly declares not only that it is truly Jesus, but something much more than that, that Jesus is his Lord and his God, which is the only possible conclusion he can reach at seeing Jesus alive after his crucifixion and death. The ambience of that upper room changed completely when Jesus entered. All anxieties, doubts, fears, and regrets vanish as he appears, and in their place is what he prayerfully wishes, profound peace, and with it joy. This is what is meant to be for us as well. As we assemble, as did those original apostles, on the evening of the first day of the week, each week, and together through word and sacrament, we are invited to encounter here the very risen Lord, truly present among us. But sadly, some like Thomas are absent, not just because of COVID, they'll be back, but there are those who are always absent, seldom coming to encounter Jesus here. And some can come and not meet him here. They end up thinking that an hour is too long, the homily went on and on, they're checking their watch, wondering what they're going to do next, and so they miss what Jesus is offering. They blame the priests for being boring, the musicians for being too loud. Indeed, some completely miss what it is that can be found here, and what those who can find it here can experience almost by just entering the church each weekend. It is what the Lord himself wants to give, his peace. And that peace is the peace that surpasses all understanding, because that peace is the peace that's possible to possess, even though the world around us, and sometimes even our own personal lives, can be in turmoil because of grief or fear or difficulty. It's a peace that comes only from the certainty that Jesus Christ is risen and he lives, and thus trusting that through him we will also rise and live forever. But that certainty can only come through faith. That is why that line in our second reading is so important, the one that reminds us that it is faith that conquers the world when the world is the world of difficulty, turmoil, and distress. Indeed, faith in Jesus overcomes that. And this is why the author of this fourth gospel reveals his purpose to us in having recorded these amazing events. He tells us plainly, it's so that we too would come to believe in Jesus Christ, and through that faith have life here and indeed forever in Jesus' name. So today, as if in the upper room with the original disciples, let us say, Lord, I do believe. And then sincerely pray, but help my unbelief. In doing so, we can have the peace of mind and heart that the Lord intends for us by taking that same leap of faith that Thomas took, as when we gaze upon the bread and wine that we consecrate here at this altar this evening, we quietly say in our hearts, my Lord and my God. And just as the original disciples knew that Jesus was with them, but without completely understanding just how that could be the case, whenever we gather in this church to worship, let us overcome all our doubts and harbor that sound assurance that just as promised, the risen Lord is truly here among us.